Hi everybody, welcome. My name is Samantha Jones and you just tuned in to a Better Me YouTube channel. I hope everybody's day is going well. I just actually wanted to do a short teaching today on modesty. I love modesty. I love talking about it. I'm a big fan of modesty. Even in today's culture, like, it's something that is very important to me. And I think it should be to all of us as believers, whether it's a man or a woman. And so before ladies get all upset, like, I'm going to address men and women as far as when it comes to the responsibility being on both ends to be modest and to be careful in how we are carrying ourselves when it comes to the opposite sex, but not even just the opposite sex, but even people of the same sex. Because you don't know, like, what your brother and sister in Christ has come out of, or what they're trying to come out of, what the Lord is, you know, working through them in. So we always have to be mindful. But my first scripture today, I'm going to jump right in, is 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 12 to 20. And it says that all things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Foods for the stomach and the stomach for foods, but God will destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual morality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. Do you know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he said, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body. But he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So the first thing I just want to point out right there in verse 19 and 20 is that our bodies are not our own. Like, if you, regardless if you're a believer or you're not a believer, your body is really not your own. But when you choose to follow the Lord and you say, like, okay, God, I'm giving my life to you and I want to follow you, you've just invited the Holy Spirit into your life, and the Holy Spirit is now living within you. And now this body is, like, you're a temporary manager of your body, right? Like, the body does not belong to you. You didn't die for yourself and you didn't resurrect for yourself. God came down and he died for us. He resurrected for us. And so our bodies belong to him. And we have to be mindful of that. That in that, like, this body is not my own. So I can't just do with it what I want to do with it. Right? Like, everything that we do, it should be submitted to God the Father, saying, like, okay, Lord, is this okay for me to do? God, is this okay for me to wear? Is it going to glorify you? Is it going to glorify the innocence and the presence of the Holy Spirit within my life? Or is it going to give people another idea about who I am and the God that I say I serve? So just keeping that in mind. And when I say that, I want you guys to understand that it's all about love. I know sometimes when it comes to these topics about modesty and just other things that the Lord tells us to do or tells us not to do, immediately people think legalism. And they feel like, oh, I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't do this. But instead of looking at it as what I can't do and God is trying to restrict me because he hates me and he's this mean God, look at it as, okay, why is he telling me to? Always look at the why behind what the Lord tells us to do. And anytime you look at the why behind it, it's always rooted in love, right? It's always rooted in love. So he loves you so much and he cares for your temple so much that he was willing to die for you. And because he loves you so much, he doesn't want you just, with all due respect, putting on a cheap piece of clothing, having your body exposed for everyone to see, right? He loves you that much and he wants to clothe you. He wants to cover you, right? Like, you're worth so much more than just being exposed to whoever comes and goes. So look at it in that sense, like, the Lord loves you, right? He loves you. He loves you. He loves you, right? I can't say it enough. He loves you. So the other scripture that I want to go to is 1 Timothy chapter 2. First Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. And it says, I desire therefore that the men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. In like manner also that the women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with propriety and moderation, not with braided hair of gold or pearls or costly clothing, but which is proper for women professing godliness with good works. I'm gonna stop right there because we're not gonna go into the prior because I know everybody just ready for a debate. But we're gonna stop right there because the focus today is modesty. And what I want to point out in that scripture is that truthfully, like, there is nothing wrong with being beautiful, and there's nothing wrong with jewelry. There's nothing wrong with, I'll even say, like, there's nothing wrong with makeup. You know, there's nothing wrong with wanting to look beautiful. But for one, when it comes to all of those things, the scripture says in moderation. And I know some, like, may not like that I say this, and, you know, that's fine, whatever. But the scripture, like, this is our standard, right? Like, not what society says, not what my emotion says, and not what I want. The scriptures is our standard, and it says these things, like, it doesn't say they're wrong, but it just says in moderation. So when it's to the point where it's excessive, and that's all that people see when they look at you, and that's all that you're known for, there's something wrong. As women of God, as people of God, we should be known for Christ. We should be known for our Christ-like characteristics. Like, all of these things on the outside, those are just things that should be added onto it. But what you should really be known for is who you are on the inside. And I think that's what, you know, should be important, is like, what do people know us for? Right? When people, and I've told people this, I did a fellowship with a few days ago. And one thing I said to them is that if you were to go to someone and say, okay, three words to describe me, somewhere in there, it should have something to do with the fact that you are a woman of God, or something attributed to Christ and his characteristics or ways of Christ. But if they just know because you always look good and your weave is always done, and you know what I'm saying, then that's what they know you for. And that's not what people should know us for. It should have something to do with Christ. That should be the reason that people know us. The other scripture I want to go to is 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. And it says, "Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives, when they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear. Do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husbands." And verse 6 says, "As Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are if you do good and are not afraid with any terror." So just focusing on verses 3 down, it says, "Do not let your adornment be merely outward." And it kind of goes back to, like, what was already said. These things are fine, but, like, don't let that be, like, the only thing that you are known for. And it says, rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart. Let that be what people know you for. Let it be that she's gentle. Let it be that she has a beautiful spirit of humility. Or that he's so wise. He's, you know, so strong in his word. Or that she's a strong leader. Like, let it be known for things that people can attribute to Christ and that reflects Christ. Another point that I wanted to hit on, I think it's in, oh, wait a minute. Maybe it's back in 1 Timothy, I'm sorry. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 10, I just want to point out that it says, "But which is proper for women professing godliness with good works." So just what the Lord really stood out to me there, it said that what is proper for a woman, basically what is proper for a woman of God to be wearing. And how do we know what is proper for a woman of God to be wearing? Let's look at Romans chapter 12. Let's go to that verse. Verses 1 and 2, it says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." So how do you know what is proper for a woman of God? What is proper for a woman of God is what separates her from the things of this world. It's what reflects Christ. Christ is, you have Christ on one side and you have the world on this side. And so look at the world and everything that this world stands for. Look at, I know we don't want to do it and we don't want to accept it. A lot of us don't want to accept it, but a lot of the things that women in the world are wearing shouldn't be things that we as women of God are wearing. It should be proper for us as women of God. So it shouldn't be revealing, right? And I'm going to talk about the men too, I'm coming. But it shouldn't be, you know, revealing. It shouldn't, whether it's jeans or skirts, and I'll share my testimony about, you know, the fact that I wear skirts majority of the time and why I do that. But even if it's jeans, there should be a difference in your jeans and the way that women in the world wear their jeans. So that's, whether that's the tightness of it. I know one of the things that is new these days is that, you know, they're like slits in a lot of jeans now. And I think it's cute, like it's fine. But when it's all up here and half of your thigh is hanging out, it's kind of like, come on y'all, like we look just like the world. And that's the thing, if people were to look at you and they look at a woman in the world, are they gonna, if you never told them that you were a Christian and they were just to look at you, would they be able to tell that there's a difference? Like, would they be able to see that there's a difference based on what you are wearing? There should be some type of difference in the way that we carry ourselves versus the way that a woman in the world carries herself. And you know, I said I was going to get to the men, but understand that the responsibility is for men and women. And I was watching another YouTube channel and it made me upset. I heard, and she was a Christian girl, but she was, you know, basically saying that the responsibility was on the man, right? Like they shouldn't look, they shouldn't look. It's their issue if they lust and if they look at a woman in that way with that intent in their heart. And the reality is, it's not just their responsibility, it's both responsibility. So the same way that women should be mindful of the jeans and how tight it is or how low cut our shirts are and making sure our bellies ain't, you know, hanging out and stuff or whatever the case is, it's the same way a man should be careful too. Meaning, y'all don't need to be wearing all these tight muscle shirts, right? Women lust too, right? Like I remember like trying to go to the gym back in the day. I still go to the gym, but like trying to go to the gym back in the day and you know, y'all got these white beaters on, just everything is just hanging out and I'm trying to focus, right? I'm trying to chase after the Lord, but it's a little hard for me in the gym because of all of these distractions around me. You guys cause women to lust too. It's not just women that cause men to lust. So it is your responsibility as well to make sure that you're covering as well. Like the same responsibility that a woman has to do things in moderation and to conceal, right? Like it's not to be exposed, ladies. It's not, and it's the same thing for a man. It's not to be exposed. Conceal yourself. Cover yourself up. Right? Like, cover yourself up. Cover yourself up. It is responsibility on both ends. And some of these guys, I don't know what's going on. Some of these jeans are just a little too tight. And I'm not being funny when I say it, but just some, it's too much. It's too much. We both parties have a responsibility to be modest, to make sure that we are concealing. Just because you have it doesn't mean that it needs to be flaunted. The Bible says, I think is in the first verse that we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, it says, just because it's okay doesn't mean that you should do it. Just because it's lawful doesn't mean that we should do it. So just because, you know, I have this beautiful shape and I could wear these jeans and, you know, I know how it's going to fit me doesn't mean that I should do it, right? And it's not always a matter of, you know, I hear some women say, well, I'm not going to go to hell. Or a man will say, well, I'm not going to go to hell if I do it. And it's not a matter of heaven and hell. It's just a matter of love and respect for one another. Right? Like if I am a Christian and I'm following Christ, I have Christ inside of me, I should have respect and I should love my brothers and sisters in Christ enough to wear, even if that means I have to sacrifice what I'm wearing and how I carry myself so that I'm not a stumbling block for other people, I should be willing to do that. Christ was willing to give up his life. And some of us are not even willing to give up a pair of jeans. Something is wrong with that. Like we have to die to ourselves, and sometimes it's for the betterment of other people. So just before I close out, I want to share my personal testimony. Anybody that knows me knows that majority of the time, you may see me like in sweats every now and then or something like that, or like dress pants if it's dealing with like business or something, but most of the time I wear skirts. And the reason I wear skirts is there two times the Lord dealt with me on this issue was that the first time I was in my quiet time and I heard the Lord say, okay, like I only want you to wear skirts. And I remember thinking, like, I know I'm not hearing the Lord. I'm going crazy. Like, I was born and raised in the Pentecostal church. And my grandmother was raised, you know, like she only wears skirts. That's all I knew her to wear. But I personally was not raised only wearing skirts and dresses. Like, I always wore jeans. But long story short, I was obedient. I struggled, but I was obedient. And I started wearing the dresses and I started wearing the skirts. And I remember just like being on campus. This is when I was in my undergrad year. And, you know, I would be on campus walking around and I started to realize that the attention that I usually would get in my jeans, I was no longer getting in my skirts and dresses. And because I wasn't getting that attention, I realized I started really struggling. Like, I didn't feel beautiful anymore. I didn't feel worthy anymore. And what the Lord was showing me through that is, Samantha, like, your identity is not in me like you say it is, right? Like, sometimes we say things because it sounds good as a Christian and that's what we should say, but that's not the reality. And it took for the Lord to change my wardrobe to realize that my identity was in my outward appearance, and it was in the attention that I was receiving from the opposite sex, not in who in Christ, who I said it was in. So the Lord showed me that, and I was in skirts and dresses for a little bit, and then he released me and said, okay, you can wear jeans. And I was like the happiest camper, like, yes, I'd be cute again. Like, started wearing my jeans again. And the second time, I remember walking around on campus, or maybe I had went back to, I think by this time, I went back to the skirts and dresses after he told me that first time. And I remember walking around on campus, and the Lord must have done some type of work in me, because I started to realize that the attention that I was starting to get because of these jeans, like, I felt so uncomfortable and I felt so naked. And I do remember the first time I actually put my jeans back on after wearing skirts and dresses for a period of time, I literally walked out on campus, I got attention, and I went back to my room and put my skirt back on. Because I felt so naked and I felt so exposed, and because the Lord has started to work in me to where my, you know, my validation and what I was seeking was no longer from man, it was from Christ, right? Like, I started being built up in who I was in Christ, and not because of how I look, but because of who I was on the inside and who I am to him. So I remember going back to the skirts and dresses, and I can't remember if it was a second time that the Lord told me to go back to the skirts and dresses. So I think for a while I was going back and forth. I was wearing skirts sometimes, I was wearing my jeans sometimes. I was struggling with, like, if I felt ugly, I would go put my jeans on, but then I would feel naked, so I would go put my skirts and dresses back on. It was a crazy roller coaster. But it was another time, the second time, that the Lord told me to go back to wearing skirts and dresses. And I remember walking around on campus, and this was going into the summer, springtime, and the hotter it gets, the less clothes you see. And I remember walking around on campus and I felt like a heaviness come over me. And I remember saying, like, I was praying and I was like, Lord, what is this? Like, what is going on? Like, I literally felt like a weight on me. And I heard the Lord say, he said, this is exactly what your brothers in Christ are feeling as they're walking around on campus and they're trying to resist temptation. And it's like the Lord was telling me to pay attention. I was paying attention to women and what they were bringing. Everything was just exposed. Everything was exposed. And God was showing me, like, Samantha, when you wear things that are revealing, it doesn't just affect you, it affects the people that are around you. And he really showed me it's a selfish mindset to only think about yourself and what you want to wear, not realizing how it can cause other people to stumble. And that goes back to what some women will say, where it's like, well, they should just control how they look. Like, I'm not going to fix what I want to wear because they're affected by it. How do you know that they're not trying to keep their eyes focused on Christ? Like, they're not intentionally looking at you to lust, but how do you know that they're not struggling? And one thing I had to realize is if my brothers in Christ are going to struggle with lust in their hearts, it's not going to be because of me. It's not going to be because I'm choosing to be exposed or wear something that's too tight. The Bible says that men should lift up holy hands. Some of us are so exposed that they can't lift up holy hands. They're lusting the whole time that they're around you. And I said, if they're going to lust and if they're going to stumble, it shouldn't be because of us. They're sisters in Christ, right? We should be the ones that are encouraging them, that are uplifting them, that are praying for them, not being their stumbling block. So I just want us to keep that in mind, that what we wear, how we carry ourselves, it doesn't just affect us. It's two parts. One is that, like I said in the beginning, the Lord loves you so much that he doesn't want you walking around exposed and just revealing yourself to everyone. For two, especially women that are seeking husbands, let me be honest with you. And I've talked to several men of God and they've all said the same. And when I say men of God, like, I mean real men of God, not just go to church and I say I'm a Christian, but like people that are really seeking after the heart of God, like men that are prayer warriors, that study the word of God. they have all said the same thing. Like, their focus is different when they're looking for a woman of God. You know, sometimes we think, of course they want someone that's beautiful and you carry yourself in a nice way and in a respectable way. But a man of God, let me be honest, he doesn't want to see his woman half exposed. He does not want to see other men looking at you. And I've heard some men in the world say that, like, well, it's an honor when other guys look at my girl. Something wrong with you. You perverted. Something is really wrong with you. Because any true man, you know what I'm saying? God says that, the Bible says that God is a jealous God, right? Like, he doesn't want to share you with anyone. And men are that same way. They were created in his image. They're jealous, right? And not in a crazy, you know what I'm saying, crazy jealous way, but they don't want to share their woman with anybody. They want you to be just for them. So think about that. A true man of God, he's looking at your outward appearance and he considers that. But it goes back to the scripture in Peter and in Timothy. What he really wants to see is, does she pray? Does she hear from God, right? Is she humble? Can I lead her, right? Is she a good example in her community? Is she a woman of integrity? He wants to see your character. Everything on the outside is an added bonus, but what he really wants to see is who you are in Christ. And I don't want to make this all about women, but, you know, I have to be honest, you know, a lot of times that's where the immodesty comes in, is with us as women. And so I just want us to come out of this selfish mindset. And I know some people are still going to walk away and say, though, that's not my responsibility. That's theirs. May God have mercy. But I pray that the Lord will open your eyes to see that it's a responsibility on both ends. We all have to be mindful of how we are carrying ourselves. Men, too. Put on some looser shirts. We don't need to see that either. Loosen up, go up a size in them pants. Like, let's all be mindful. Let's all be modest. Let's all make sure that we're not being the stumbling block to one another. So I hope that encourages somebody. I hope it makes somebody think about what they're wearing. When you go in your wardrobe or in your closet, ask the Lord, like, first of all, go in there and say, God, is there anything in here that's not pleasing to you? Is there anything that's too low cut? Is there anything that's too short? Is there anything too tight? And that's another thing I'm going to say. Women that are skinnier in shape, like, you may be more petite, you may not be as, you know, curvy, that does not give you a license to wear what you want to wear. I see some women that are skinnier, but they still have stuff that are super tight. I don't care what your size is, you should still be modest. Things should not be so tight where if you turn to the side, we can see your figure. Regardless, it just because you have thinner legs doesn't mean it should be shorter. Whether your shape, whether your size, whether you're a man or a woman, modesty. Be mindful of how you carry. If I gotta be modest in how I'm carrying myself and mindful in how I'm carrying myself because I'm curvy, women that are smaller in shape should have that same responsibility as well. It's for everybody. So, like I said, go in your closet. God, is there anything in here that's not pleasing to you? And if it is, get rid of it, right? And as you dress every day, ask the Lord, like, God, what do you want me to wear today? Because I want to be pleasing to you. And that's what it's all about. It's all about glorifying God and showing love to other people. So I just hope this encourages someone today. Please feel free to give feedback and share insights as well. And I thank you for tuning in. I hope you have a great day.